This is the opening night of the 26th edition of the Winternachten International Literature Festival. My name is Mirthe Vrees and I will be your moderator tonight. Welcome to this online version of Winternachten. And we really do miss your physical presence here at Theater aan het Spui. But we're also so happy to bring this online festival into your living rooms, maybe at your kitchen tables, or maybe you're even watching us tonight from a hot and foamy bath. So this year's main theme of the festival is It's Up to Us, or in Dutch, Het is aan ons. And it will be explored during the whole festival by writers, poets, spoken word artists, journalists, performers from all over the world. And in the next couple of days, we have different programs which all approach this theme from a different angle. We will dive into Back to Earth, about climate and imagination, The Future is Female on feminism, Soul Care, Peace of Mind and Solidarity, and Still We Rise on activism. So It's Up to Us is a statement made by one of my guests tonight, writer Eva Meijer, as she was speaking about her new book, De Nieuwe Rivier, The New River. And she said, it's no longer up to you, the individual, to make a difference. It's up to us. And tonight we will present you with a kaleidoscopic overview of what us actually means, because which us are we referring to? And what is the power or the danger of us? And is it really up to us? So now joining me live from New York is the well-known writer Arnon Grunberg with his opening statement on what us means to him. Arnon.
Oops, can you hear me?
Yes, I hear you now.
Yes, perfect. Thank you. So I'm going to read my opening statement now.
Yes, great.
Okay, I will. It's called The Religion of Group Identity. Early in January of this year, Haaretz, an Israeli newspaper, reported that Avraham Burke, chairman of the Israeli parliament from 1999 through 2003, had asked the Jerusalem court to exclude him from the denomination Jewish in a municipal register. I've no desire to get into a discussion here of the all too thorny question of what it is that constitutes the difference between nationality, ethnicity, religion, and race. What is certain is that people have divided themselves into groups, and that enormous differences exist in the consequences of that division. Membership of a table tennis club usually has less far-reaching consequences than membership of a country, which generally involves a passport and a fair number of rights and obligations. The stateless person has fewer rights, and it is for good reason that there is currently a ban on rendering people stateless. In other times, citizens deemed worth of punishment were sent into exile, made stateless, in fact. But today we consider that as undesirable as waging war with poison gas. Overseeing compliance with rights or laws is almost always a task of the state itself. There are, of course, supranational organizations, such as the UN, but they're not so adept at enforcing the laws, the resolutions passed by the organization. That is why conservative opponents of the UN have compared it with a debating club. Some kinds of memberships are, or were, as we well know, a matter of life and death. What interests me in the case of Burke is that apparently you can disassociate yourself from a membership that, as Burke agrees, touches upon the core of one's identity. In her essay on responsibility, Hannah Arendt talks about memberships of groups that cannot be annulled by any voluntary action on the part of the member. A membership of that kind is utterly unlike what she refers to as a business partnership. There are accordingly voluntary and less voluntary forms of membership. Cancelling one's membership does not automatically entail that one is thereby acquitted of all the blame that said membership brings with it. I believe that's what Arendt is saying. The cancellation must be more than just a form of reputation laundering. With this reservation in mind, I have to admit that I'm quite fond of the possibility of terminating any and all memberships that come my way. Although I hasten to add that to the extent that suicide is a form of terminating one's membership, I'm not a propagandist for the taking of one's own life. The Jew, the Christian, and the Muslim cannot only bid farewell to their faith, but can also state, when it comes to culture, I'm no longer part of this either. We are not captives, or at least much less than we once were, of the gender given us by birth. To the extent that freedom results in a variety of choices, and along with that, responsibility of one's own, such freedom is always a two-edged sword. Making our own choices, as we all know, places a burden on our shoulders. The Black person, the Asian, the South American, etc., should be able to say, I'm no longer Black or Asian, etc. Cancelling a membership will always be seen by some of the other members as betrayal and a lack of solidarity, particularly when one belongs to a minority that has been persecuted. The cult of victimhood has seen to it that membership of a group these days almost always amounts to membership of a given sort of victimhood. In exceptional cases, one becomes a member of a given sort of culprithood. Group identity resembles religion. Some people think that a believer's relationship to God can only pass by way of the institution of the church, mosque, synagogue. Others see the relationship as a singularly individual affair between the believer and God. I subscribe to the latter school of thought. Although I'm not a believer, I consider my relationship to my own visions, to the existential issues that shape me, and that I, for the sake of argument, am willing to call God, to be a purely personal affair. I acknowledge my own loneliness. In fact, I believe that that particular loneliness is the mark of what we call being human. And from that proceeds the right to cancel memberships. It would seem to me a fine thing if, perhaps with a bit of help from technology, humans in the future could also say farewell to their membership in humanity and join, for example, the club of what we might call goatness. This sounds like a novel idea, but Greek mythology already contained creatures that were half men, half billy goats, the so-called satyrs. The individualist encounters resistance because he is seen as egoistic and lacking in solidarity. But such resistance is based only on the fear that the individualist may be a spy who fails to make clear where his or her loyalties lie. He who comes to the conclusion that the right to be a heretic is the crucial right, perhaps even the most important right of all, can no longer place his faith unreservedly in the religion of group identity. Thank you.
Thank you, Arnon, for these ideas about membership, loneliness, and goatness. You will stay with us tonight. You will watch the program. And at the end, we'll come back to you, to New York, and we will hear some final thoughts or remarks, or maybe you have a question. And I'm really curious whether your ideas about this us will alter anyway after listening to the other writers tonight. So we'll see you later, but thank you for now, Arnon. So yeah, during this evening, I will further talk about It's Up to Us with writers Tsitsi Dangarembga and Samanta Schweblin. We will listen to contributions, especially written for the festival by Salena Godden, Simone or Simon van Saarloos, and Jaap Tielbeke. And they wrote pieces that relate to the overall theme, but also to programs of the upcoming days. And we will finish the program with the ceremony of the PEN Freedom of Speech Awards. But now we will start with Eva Meijer and Raoul de Jong. Welcome. I will give you a proper introduction. Eva Meijer, you're a philosopher, singer-songwriter, and writer of 9 books, which were translated in more than 17 languages, if I'm correct. You did a PhD on political animal voices. And in 2018, you won the Halewijn Prize for your complete oeuvre. And your latest novel is called, I already said, It's the New River, and it's a magical, realist murder mystery. Raoul de Jong, welcome. You're writer and journalist. You write for many Dutch newspapers and magazines. You already wrote 7 books, including Life is Terrible, Diary of a Teen. And your latest novel, this one, is called Jaguar Man, My Father, His Father, and Other Surinamese Heroes, in which you travel to Suriname, the land of your ancestors, to search for traces of the Jaguar Man. So welcome. So for tonight, of course, we could talk hours about your books. We're not going to do that. We're going to talk about relationships between your books and your thoughts to the theme It's Up to Us. And I thought, Eva, if you would like to start, because where do we talk about when we talk about us, to read a little bit or paraphrase a little bit in English from your book, The Soldier Was a Dolphin.
Thank you for your introduction. And it's really lovely to be here at the festival. So, I'm going to read a little bit about this book, The Soldier Was a Dolphin, actually deals with political relationships between humans and other animals. So this is a small excerpt. Humans in Western communities often tend to think about themselves as separate from others. They see themselves as individuals on the one hand, and on the other hand, as a separate species from the other animal species. We also use the word animal to designate all the other animals, so it's already happening in the language. However, we are connected to all kinds of others from different species on different levels, politically, socially, culturally, economically, and emotionally. Some of these relationships are very intimate. For example, when we live together with creatures from different species, or even eat them, as some human beings do. But also on the level of politics and social groups, we find that relationships between different species play a role in how we act and how we can act.
Thank you. So, Raoul, in your book, you write about the upper god within the religion of Winti, and it's called Anana, or Anana Kaduaport. Mm. And she says, like, everything is Anana. And in how much does this belief relate to what Eva here is saying?
Even kijken. Well, first of all, Winti is like a religion which is based on African gods that were brought to the New World on slave ships. And in this New World, these African gods mixed with the gods of the native people that were living there. And it, this new religion also took elements of Christianity. And Anana is the main god, what we would call God. According to Anana, according to Winti, everything is Anana. So a human being is Anana, but also an ant is Anana, or a tree is Anana. So it doesn't put human beings in the center of everything. It says everything, all life is equally important. And I think it's a very nice God. it's basically a God that I would like to believe in. It's a very alternative to, for example, the Christian God that says that only humans are created in the image of God.
Yeah.
And this God also said on the day that it created humans, that these humans were meant to rule on over all other life on Earth. And if you see that, that's basically the cause, the root of so many of the problems that we face today.
Well, maybe you can read a little bit from Jaguar Man, in which you also write about this everything is everything.
Yeah.
You have it, yeah.
I have it printed out, the English version. Even kijken, yeah, so this is a moment I'm in the rainforest and I'm trying to understand the two native guides that are taking me to the rainforest, and it's very hard because we have a different language. And I understand that it's hard even asking questions because they don't understand my questions. We talk and we see reality in a different way. And then I understand I could ask what it is like to be a flower. But even if flowers were to understand my question, I would still have to somehow take on the guise of a flower before I could understand their answer. But maybe that was exactly your point, Jaguar Man. Looking at Johannes, my guide, I started suspecting this was something human beings are actually capable of. Florification, formification, jaguarification. Isn't it rather like looking at the world through the eyes of the black or white man opposite you in the metro, or the woman with the headscarf next to you in the tram? We're not the same, but in our differences, we have a lot in common. We're part of the same creation.
Thank you. Yeah, Eva, I've heard you talk about kind of this multivocal us. Is this also, does this relate to what Raoul reads out, or is it something different?
I think there are differences because Raoul is now talking about a specific type of religious story, basically, that we tell ourselves, or that some people tell themselves. And he connects that to his own experience, to your own daily experience, yeah, basically. And I think that for me, working from the standpoint of politics, it's more about understanding that within the dominant framework of political voice, there's a lot of exclusion. So we tend to think about language as something that is solely human, which also ties back to what you were saying. But there are many other beings, non-human animals, who also have voices and express themselves in different ways. And this is literally it's a polyphonic way of thinking about language and voice. I think that there is a connection in the idea that we are interconnected with a lot of others, but there are also differences.
Yeah, because let's go to the "it's up to us" and "it's not up to you." You had an interview and there you said, "it's not up to you, it's up to us."
Yes.
What did you mean when you said that?
Well, in the new river, suddenly a new river comes into being because the land is completely dry because of soy plantations. It's a river in a fictive South American country. And it's very unclear if it's the humans who caused this or if it's maybe the old gods in the land who are angry because of the way that humans treat this land. So that's kind of the tension in the book. But beneath that, the story sort of connects to all kinds of questions that we are dealing with now. Some people say that we live in the Anthropocene, the age that has been the geological era that has been influenced by human activity in such a way that it's actually altering geological processes. And in this Anthropocene, we see a lot of human-made problems, such as the climate crisis, but also the river that came into being. And what I'm trying to look at in the river, in the new river, is how the different types of stories that we as humans tell ourselves, so scientific stories, stories through media and newspapers, but also the older stories, the stories of the gods and the land. And that's not just simply, that's not simply only happening in other countries. We also have a history of nature gods in Europe. And when I was asked to speak about this this book, and I was interviewed by a program, and then you always have to write a slogan on a tile, and I really felt the thing is that we cannot solve the questions that we are dealing with alone. These are not solely ethical questions. They're not questions about how we as humans should live a good life only as individuals. They are really also political questions. So that means that it is up to us. And what this us is, is precisely in question, because what the Anthropocene shows us is that we over here in the Netherlands are connected to different kinds of human beings in different parts of the world. For example, in South America, where there are now large soy plantations to create soy for animal feed, because that's used in intensive farming here. So we're connected to the people over there, but also the wild animals who live there and who lose their habitats because of these plantations. Also to the animals over here that some people eat. All of these things are connected in different kinds of networks. Mm-hmm. So where is the we? You know, where is the solidarity? Where is the are the points of connection? And what Arnon just told us was how we is often formed by shared characteristics in groups and perhaps also by the eyes of the other. Yeah. Others often make us into we. But there are many different ways of approaching this we. And I think that the starting point for thinking about we is understanding that we are connected materially, politically, socially, but also that there are many, many differences. Even within existing we's, everybody is different. So these are very, these are fraught categories, but we still need them if we want to make an impact. Sorry.
Raoul, because I think you do believe in the interconnectedness of everything, but still you really make a plea for, no, it's not up to us, it's up to you. And then especially you believe in the power of individuals. Could you elaborate on that?
Okay, well, I said it's up to you because, well, yeah, like Arnold maybe was saying, when I think about us, the first thing I think is usually when there's a us, there's also another. And if you look at like the biggest tragedies in our history, they were usually caused by people that were believing in a us. And in order to have this us, there was another. And as soon as there's another, it sort of opens the doors towards destruction and suppression. So for that reason, I said, no, it's not up to us, it's up to you. And I also said that because, well, it is up to you. You are what you have to do it with. And you should not wait for us to change things. You should start with yourself and what you have on your doorstep.
Because when I was reading your book, it is really, it is maybe looking for an us where you also fit in, but by doing that, you really look at individual persons. And when you were saying, Eva, like you need an us to really change something.
Yeah.
What I got from you, your book, is that sometimes you need just one very powerful individual. Could you?
That's what I found out when I studied this dark history of Suriname. Sometimes things changed for the better, and it always started with one person. yeah, that was an individual that used his brains and his human heart and fought for yeah. himself or herself. And it was never appreciated, not by the people who had the power, but usually also not by the people that they were trying to change things for. But still, because they stayed true to themselves and to this bigger truth, they did what they did. And that's the way that things changed for the better. It was always one person. It was never, it never started with a group. It always started with one person.
How do you see that, Eva? Like this the power of you know, individuality, of autonomous thinking, with regard to the power that a group can have, you know, to also really make change. Like, what is the is it a tension or not? Is it?
Well, I mean, I think it's in part an empirical question. So how does social progress come about? You could even say that it doesn't even start with one person, but that it starts with a society that is almost ready, and then one person brings it over the threshold. But these are, in part at least, empirical questions that will differ from situation to situation and society to society. And I think that we are very aware of the dangers, that was also what Raoul just said, of the we, they thinking. And I think if you are a human being that doesn't fit into a we, then you are very aware. And I think every writer, I mean, as a writer, you cannot be part of a we. I mean, you have to be
very... Yeah, I was thinking that when I was like, is a writer not always at the outskirts?
Yeah, you have to be sort of out of it. But not all writers are. I mean, a lot of writers also affirm the status quo and not challenge it. But still, there is... we cannot, there's just too much. For example, I'm quite into, I do a lot of work for, I do a lot of animal activism. And this is such a huge problem that I cannot change that single-handedly, and other people also can't. You need like a lot of human beings doing this type of work.
But it starts with you being aware of the fact that you can love an animal like you can love yourself. No, it still starts with you coming to that realization.
Yeah, but it doesn't, I mean,
because I've heard you said, I don't find the individual that important. Like,
well, I think that as, these are the kind of different discussions at the same time. I don't find my own life very important. I consider myself more of a writer than of a human being, but that's maybe also slightly a different type of question. I value difference and strangeness and individuality above other things. Mm-hmm. But it's always, these are not contrasting issues. We are all interconnected. We are all dependent on others at different points of our lives. These others can be human, they can also be non-human. We depend on social structures. They can make our lives go better or worse. There are a lot of human beings who cannot change things single-handedly because they are too poor, because they die young, because they are not so lucky as some others. And we are the lucky ones who can sit here and discuss these questions, which is already extremely an extreme privilege. And so, yes, of course, we all have our special. Nobody can live your life for you. Nobody can think your thoughts for you. That's really at the basis of everything. And Arnon spoke about Hannah Arendt, and Hannah Arendt is, of course, the political theorist of the uniqueness of human beings and the difference. But from that multiplicity, new types of community can come into being with goats and humans, because I don't see a strong distinction between goats and humans. I think we overestimate species. Humans are really species fetishists. They might think that, okay, gender, oh well, we can get across these differences, but no, species, that's a border that we cannot get over. I think that's a problematic thing. So yes, the uniqueness and difference is the starting point, but we still need, sometimes need to form collectives, sometimes simply to sustain ourselves, but also as writers. I mean, writers read, so we need these books, and books are also a form of communication and a form of
becoming the other also.
Becoming the other and living in these different worlds.
And how do you perceive then your role as a writer? Like, what do you make new stories for new us to, you know, to recognize each other and to recognize?
No, I think, I mean, first of all, I have no control over what I do anyway. So I simply sit down and write a book, and the book writes me. So that's kind of I'm not above the book in any sense. Yeah. I just try to do justice to the story, and I think that I write about topics that interest me and that I find important, but I don't think that as a writer you have to get a message across or something, because messages are very problematic. They're part of the we, they populist paradigm. So we problematize things. Life is difficult, and we try to do justice to that.
You said, Raoul, to know which story you would like to tell, you should first know what story you're living in.
Yeah.
What did you mean by that?
I didn't say this myself. This was a Winty priest that told me this. And to me, that basically meant like, well, first you should become aware that you are living in a story. And if you are aware that you are living in a story, then you understand, oh, I can change it.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's what it meant.
Also with regard to what truth is, maybe, or what, you know, what is considered as
well,
truth.
It's again, you have the power to change it. You shouldn't underestimate the power that you have as an individual. Yeah. You can change things, you can make it better. Yeah. And sometimes it's as small as doing your hands like this when everybody else is Sikh heiling. Yeah. But you can change things. Yeah.
Thank you. I want to talk with you much more, but we can't. I really recommend to read those books. I love them. And I really would like to close this talk with a piece of your book, Raoul.
Okay. We can prevent hell on earth by continuing to be thoughtful, by remaining true to our soft human hearts, by choosing from the options we are offered the one that leads to the light, by not allowing any fairy tales to come between us and reality, by looking around us and what actually is, by not forgetting that the life that came before us and this whole singing planet are on our side. This book was not about my father, dear reader. It was not about white or black or the Netherlands or Suriname, although all those elements did play a part. This book was about us. We ourselves are the Jaguar Men. We were born as the Jaguar Men. To become a Jaguar Man is what's in our destiny. We can embrace our destiny or we cannot. Amen.
Thank you so much, Raoul and Eva. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now we go live to London to Salena Godden. Welcome, Salena. Salena Godden is an icon of the British spoken word scene, one of Britain's most beloved poets and performers, a social and political activist and a radio producer. In 2018, she published Pessimism is for Lightweights, 13 Pieces of Courage and Resistance, in which was inspired by protests and demonstrations about issues such as women's rights, justice, sexism, racism, immigration and identity. And her debut novel, Mrs. Death, Mrs. Death, will be published in late January 2021. Salena, the screen is yours.
Thank you so much and hello to everyone. It's an honour to be invited back here. Okay, so I'm just going to shoot from the top. We could be heroes. How the survival of the hero is up to us all now. Your heroes are here. Your heroes are all already here, darling. I see your heroes. I follow them. I watch them. They keep going and they never stop. Your heroes are never giving up on their dreams. I see heroes at the food bank. Your heroes are at homeless shelters. They take food to people sleeping in doorways. Your heroes are itinerant and broke, with no funding or arts grants. Your heroes are in Calais and Dunkirk. They wait by the shores of Mediterranean seas and volunteer to help the capsized boats and refugees. Your heroes are on the borders. Your heroes are down in Soho donating and distributing food and blankets. Your heroes are working overtime in the crumbling NHS. Your heroes are your doctors and your nurses, your teachers and volunteers, people taking phone calls at the Samaritans and talking people down from the edge. Your heroes march for human rights and the future of the planet. Your heroes are millions of schoolchildren protesting for the climate strike. Your heroes write graffiti and poetry. Your heroes are everywhere. They walk among us. Your heroes are waking up every day, skint and underpaid and busking it. Your heroes are making work, beautiful books and music and art, but you cannot see or find it or read it as is it drowned out by all the propaganda and noise and adverts and fear-mongering and all the performative cruelty of the politicians. It is your job, your only job, to seek out and support and nurture heroes. This is all your responsibility. We can all do our part in the chain to help others, to help others, to help the others who help the others, who inspire and help the others find the others. You are losing your libraries, museums, galleries, independent bookshops, pubs and music venues. So the beautiful spaces where thinkers and writers and artists could meet and share work and gather and blossom and dream are being erased. The survival of the hero is up to you all now. It is important, now more than ever, to fight for all of this, to fight for your rights, for your freedoms, for your art, poetry, and music. It is all about kindness. And you need the doers and the creators. You must pay attention to the ones who listen and hear and do and can and will and share. And to the people of science and art, books and music. Otherwise, what is the actual point of all of this? What was the point? Why are you all here if not for that? You are here for love, to share the love. When hate is rising, then love can only rise higher. We stare deeply now into the charcoals of winter and watch the last flames lick the chimney. The fire leaves the sky and dances into the everything. All the warmth and all the joy is boiled in a soup of memory. We stir the good stuff from the bottom of the pot. We hold the ladle up. Drink, we say. Look at all the good chunks of goodness. Take in your share of good times, good music, good books, good food, good laughter, good people. Be grateful for the good stuff, life and death. We say, drink. Thank you.
Thank you, Salena, for this piece. And what I got from this is it's up to us to seek out and support and nurture heroes and to do our part in the chain to help others, to help the others who help the others, who inspire and help the others. Thank you very much. We now go live to Zimbabwe, to Harare, where I will talk to Tsitsi Dangarembga. Hi, Tsitsi. Do you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, I was just unmuting there. Hello.
Hello. I will first give you a proper introduction. Tsitsi Dangarembga is an award-winning writer of novels, plays and short stories, as well as a successful filmmaker. She began writing stories and plays in the early 80s, followed by her debut novel, Nervous Conditions. Her novel, The Book of Not, was published in 2006, and This Mortal Body, where is it? Here, in 2018, which was shortlisted for the 2020 Booker Prize. Thank you, Tsitsi, it's great to have you here. So,
thank you. It's great to be here.
So the main theme of this festival is it's up to us. And I was wondering, when you heard this sentence, how does this resonate with you and how does it resonate in the current context of Zimbabwe?
Well, yes, the theme it's up to us really resonates with me as a Zimbabwean very much. Because Zimbabwe is in the midst of an increasing national crisis, and the humanitarian toll of it, the cost of it, it is really just beginning to become apparent with the second wave of COVID-19 that we experience now. And it is quite horrendous. For years, we have had a situation where services were declining. There was dwindling service delivery in health, in education, in transport, in sanitation, everything you could think of. And as those services declined, we had an increase in all kinds of forms of misgovernance, an increase in many kinds of repression, increases in fraud and corruption. And so COVID-19 has really laid bare all those fault lines. And many people in Zimbabwe in the NGO sector, civil society, have been saying something very similar. They have been saying, it is us and it's now. I think one of the big issues for us in Zimbabwe is to translate that kind of thought, that kind of slogan, into a thought that is understandable to the rest of the population who may not be in circles where they engage with these kinds of issues. So that kind of thought needs to be translated and to be made motivating to people who are really so beaten down that the very idea of motivation is almost like a myth.
Yeah, because you've said in an earlier interview, and I don't know if this also relates to this horrific situation that you're telling about, but that people can barely be themselves. You've described them as shrinking people, and that because there's this need for this basic, their search for just basic needs, and therefore people, even their stories shrink. What, as a writer, can you do for them?
It is not easy to do things for people as a writer when the situation is so dire. There is a point where one can engage with the subjectivity of the people through art and through culture when the people are open to reception. And being open to reception of things at that level presupposes a certain level of security.
Yeah.
So that people are not really thinking, if I get a cough today, I might die before I get to the hospital.
Yeah.
Or even, how will I get to the hospital? A taxi or an ambulance from one of the satellite towns to the big referral hospital in Harare can cost up to $270. So people really are in a situation where they think we are just going to die. So when a person gets to such a low level of drive and energy, it is very difficult to motivate them about things that have to do with their subjectivity.
Yeah.
One has to then attend to those issues, those humanitarian issues first, and raise people to a level where they have a sense of security about their lives from moment to moment, so that they can then engage not simply with the idea of, am I alive, but with the idea of what is the nature, what is the quality of my life.
Yeah. And how does this current crisis affect you as a writer? Do you feel, is writing an escape, or do you still have headspace to write, or is writing the last thing on your mind right now?
Oh, I definitely write, because as a writer, that's what I do. That's how I manage my life. I manage by writing. But I am aware that the average person in Zimbabwe is not going to be able to buy that book. You did ask a very good question about then what does writing actually serve? Well, there are people who are not in Zimbabwe. Yeah. And these can be Zimbabweans, or they can be people who are not Zimbabwean. Zimbabwe is said to have between 2 and 4 million people in the diaspora now. So that's between 2 and 4 million people who are not in this dire situation that I describe, who can be impacted by those kinds of engagements with the subjective that we find in literature and in other creative forms. And then there are other people in the world whose actions and thoughts and behaviors and policies and laws also affect people in Zimbabwe. Yeah. So it is useful, in my opinion, to continue to write. And of course, the situation in Zimbabwe will change. Yeah. I do not know when it will change. And so it is important that one is prepared with enough material that is useful to people in developing their new perspective when that change does come along.
You have a library set up to them with books, with good books.
That would be lovely. I think that we are working on encouraging people to read more. And of course, one of the issues is simply to make the books more available. Books are extremely expensive anyway for the ordinary Zimbabwean. And now our government has begun to tax books and to tax them by the kilogram. Oh. So this is very interesting for us, because 40 years ago at independence, the talk was all about the importance of education and how Zimbabweans need to be educated and literate, and how Zimbabweans were extremely educated and literate. But now we are beginning to tax books by the kilogram, like meat or cement or whatever.
Yeah, so let's also get a little bit into your book. I read it with great pleasure. I thought it was also dark, and what was really interesting to me was this form you chose, like the main character, Tambuzai. She refers to herself in the you form, like she talks like you have this, you do that. And there comes this kind of estranging relationship between the reader and Tambuzai. Why did you choose this form? And what did it give you, this form?
Yes, I chose the you form, the second person form, because it seemed to do two things. It seemed to create a kind of intimacy, a kind of conspiracy, because often when people talk about something they do not want to admit to 100%, they do talk in the second person. Yeah. So that was the kind of atmosphere that I wanted to create. But also it gave me, as the writer, distance. Because the other two novels that I had written about Tambuzai, as her story is a trilogy, the other two novels had been written in the first person. Mm-hmm. But writing about Tambuzai in this mournable body was not an exercise that I was able to do successfully in the first person. Because, as you said, the subject matter is dark. Mm-hmm. And it is subject matter that is sourced from what Zimbabweans are living through now. And I live in Harare, so it was sourced from what I was going through. Yeah. We have other dark literature in Zimbabwean literature. For example, we have one of the classics, The House of Hunger by Dambudzo Marechera. He wrote it when he was in England. We have Harare North by Brian Chikwawa, also written while he was in England. And we have, for example, House of Stone by Nofio Chuma, written while she was in the United States. And so for me, I was writing about this darkness while being steeped in it.
Yeah.
And so writing in the first person just made it too overwhelming. Yeah. And I was glad to have that kind of distance for myself, which came from writing in the second person.
Yeah. My last question for now, but we will see you later this evening, is because when we... do you feel part of an us? Is there an us that feels, you know, as your place?
I don't really have an us that feels as my place, but I have a feeling of us as being a part of creation. Mm. And I think that us definitely exists and we cannot deny it. We may want to deny it and it may be useful and instrumental for us to deny it at certain times, but us exists. I think the idea of us, the idea of we, has gone through evolution with the evolution of humankind from the time when us and we might have been very small bands of early humans who hardly recognized each other, but realized that they needed each other for survival and for propagation. And then the whole idea of us grew into the idea of the community, which was based on blood, the tribe, which was an interesting form of us because within that, the individual was not as well sculpted as the individual we see today. So that was another evolution of the notion of us, where the individual began to emerge as a unit of subjectivity. From this greater morass of subjectivity that was the tribe. And now we are coming into a situation where we see we are beginning to form connections again, not exactly as they were in the tribe, but we are beginning to realize our commonality in a globalized planet.
Yeah.
And I sometimes think about particularly this second wave of COVID-19 that we are going through. For me, this is one of the times when all groups on this planet, all people on this planet are experiencing the same trauma in more or less the same way. The symptoms are manifesting in the same way at the same time, at a time when they can communicate with each other almost in real time.
Yeah.
And so I think this is going to be a very significant moment for forging a new sense of us. And I hope that we will be able to use it wisely.
Yes. Well, thank you for now, Tsitsi. And later I will see you because you were awarded with the PEN Award for Freedom of Speech. See you later. Thank you, Tsitsi.
Thank you.
So we now go to Simone or Simon van Saarloos. Is a philosopher, writer, columnist, and debate moderator. She writes literary reviews, interviews, essays, opinion pieces, and fiction. And her latest work is the essay Rethinking Commemoration, an essay to forget, about queer forgetfulness, whiteness, and embodied commemoration. And at last, Simone/Simon also makes a podcast series for Winternachten called The Asterisks Conversations, which you can find on our website and other podcast platforms. Simone/Simon van Saarloos.
I have little time and lots to say, so let me give it to you right away. Little time, a couple of minutes only with limited word count. Immediately at the start, the narrative of scarcity comes up. Scarcity has been a long-installed narrative creating our view on natural environment, economy, intimacy, and culture. We learn that there is little food, land, a lack of intelligence, agency, too little love, and beauty. Hence, we have to restrain our desires, demands, and needs. Instead of focusing on the potential of equal distribution, inequality is portrayed as a natural phenomenon. Soul care teems with abundance, not scarcity. Soul care is not about improvement, progression, or completion. Soul care isn't like Bildung. Bildung as we know it in the literary tradition, in which a character is built, rounded, complicated, page after page, details are added, the writer controls grand narratives. Bildung fits a humanist tradition, and Solker is not exclusionary human. More than human animals, plants, animate and supposed inanimate life have soul too and can be cared for. I explicitly say have soul, not a singular entity, something to point to. Having soul is multiple and does not have to be identified. It can be experienced by many and in different forms. Soul care, then, is anti-capitalist. Soul care isn't enacted to enforce manifestation. Soul care breaks the equation of care for extraction, care for growth, care to create a profitable surplus. Care is not linear. Care is not cure, and it should not be cure. Disability justice activists critically question the medical and potential focus on cure. Millions are invested in scientific research aiming to find a future cure, a resolving medicine or a technology. Incited by the pharmaceutical industry, a belief in cure establishes a single idea of what a healthy human should be. Obsessive investments in future cure projects that disability will be eradicated. Medical, eugenic, and technological change is supported to secure a single future, while change for the sake of justice is deemed impossible. Societally, we have treated disability as a future problem of the past. How did we live, or how did we expect to live okay in a COVID-affected present? While millions are spent on discovering future cures, most cultural events I attend do not have budget reserved for sign language interpretation. We seek for water on the moon to learn if life is possible while not knowing how to formulate livable life on Earth. 1/3 of the current world population lacks access to clean drinking water. This is not natural scarcity, this is distribution. A violent understanding of value. Those who propose to live life with disability, to not only accommodate or adapt people's ability to participate in the norm, but change the norm's rigid frame, those people are ignored. If disability was an appreciated point of view, streets, buildings, and nightclubs would be designed for a multitude of bodies. Different forms of access would be centralized and crip time could rule, meaning that different bodies and minds need different temporalities, speeds, and schedules. Care is not similar to cure. Care can happen if there is no cure in sight. Care is figured out intramurally and in community designed, even if there is no political concern for the lives it's most affecting. This is what a collective like What Would an HIV Doula Do proposes. The collective assigns the kind of care that is not, or that is mostly associated with birth, to living with a virus that aims to survive. Care is never a waste of time. If tomorrow your heartbreak isn't better, the care of a friend was not wasted today. If your illness progresses, the value of care is not reduced. I started this short reflection with scarcity. We have to reject the narrative in which scarcity increases value. Budgets for nursing staff, general practitioners, home caretakers, and thuiszorg have been cut and squeezed. Elderly care and doctors can spend a maximum few minutes on a person, patient. Caretakers receive applause and not a financial bonus. Paradoxically, the installation of scarcity is used to make us value care even more. In order to care for care, the growing valuation for that which is scarce has to be refused. Imagine care in abundance. Imagine abundantly caring, caring for, being cared for. That, I would say, is soul care. And inspired by Malcolm Ferdinand's work on decolonial ecology, I'd like to end with recommending a soul song by musician Gil Scott Heron. Maybe you can play it at home. It's called Whitey on the Moon.
Thank you, Simone, for your thought-provoking words, as always. Caring for being cared for, that is soul care. And this idea also of soul care really fits perfectly to the Winternachten program on Sunday night, which is completely about soul care. So we're now going to watch an interview I had earlier this afternoon with Samanta Schweblin. Samanta Schweblin has published an internationally acclaimed oeuvre of three collections of short stories, a novel, a novella, since 2002. Her work has been translated into more than 20 languages. And her latest novel is called Thousand Ogen, Little Eyes. It's a kind of dystopian novel about our complex relationship with surveillance and intimacy. Samanta Schweblin. Hi, Samanta, and welcome. Welcome to our program. We're very happy to see you from, I guess, your living room in Berlin, right?
Yep.
Yes, and well, we hope that in the near future we can really have you in The Hague. I just told that you wrote this book, Little Eyes, and it's about these Kentuckys. And they look a little bit like, in the Netherlands we had Furbies, but these strange animals. Can you tell us how you came up with the idea of a Kentucky, and what does the Kentucky symbolize for you?
Well, I have to Google what a Furby is.
Yeah.
Because I didn't know about this thing, and I don't think they are like Furbies, because in Furbies you have, well, they're kind of a robot, and then the relationship is between a robot and a human being. And in a Kentucky, the relationship is between a human being in some part of the world and another human being in some other part of the world, that they are forever connected.
Because the Kentucky is controlled by a human, right? You don't know.
But you don't know who this person is, but it will be the same person forever once that the connection is established. How the idea came, it's so hard to say. It just appeared. It was a year thinking about the problem of the drones on the cities, how much problems about privacy these drones came. But also this idea that you can stay at home and move around the life of the others in real life, no? So then the idea just came up. I don't know how this work.
And what does the Kentucky symbolize for you? What does it say about our times, these Kentuckys?
Well, I think the idea came up like that because it was a year also asking myself a big question about how fiction works with technology. I think fiction has a big problem with technology right now. So whenever you find in a novel, in a short story, in a poem, some lines that could be read like something that is tech, it's immediately labeled like tech literary or maybe science fiction, but it's not labeled like something that are part of our reality. Yeah. So my big question was why we accept with in such a natural way technology in our life, but then when we put this in books, in fiction, we label it like science fiction. What is happening here? It's not the future.
It's the reality.
Yes.
So
it was an interesting noise for me.
Yeah, that's an interesting point.
And to answer your question, so my question was, so if this is happening, how can I talk about technology, but not about technology like a device that I have to describe how it works, blah, blah, blah. No. How can I talk about our relationship with the others through technologies?
Yeah.
So the idea of the Kentucky came just to replace in some way all the technologies that we have around these days, Facebook, Twitter, I don't know, WhatsApp, Zoom, whatever it is that you need to communicate with the other.
Yeah. So the theme of this festival is called It's Up to Us. And it's also about really feeling this kind of, can you feel a connection, you know, with us? And of course, new technologies have kind of promised, and they've also delivered, to feel connected. You can be connected, you know, to people who you will maybe never meet. Mm. And so I was wondering, like, do you think new technologies succeeded in creating this kind of feeling of collectiveness? Or is the downside of feeling lonely and alienated, is that a bigger one?
I don't know. I wouldn't put that responsibility on technology. Technology is not something negative or positive, or technology is something neutral. I think we have success in some way. Mm-hmm. Because just imagine this situation of the pandemic in the world without technology, without Facebook and Twitter and all these things that we have just named. It would be a completely other scenario. But on the other hand, of course, there's a lot of loneliness. We can't expect to replace the digital connection, to replace the real connection with the digital connection. There are different things.
Is the way we feel connected online, is that, do you think, a fundamental different way we feel connected in the physical world? Or for you personally, not like just for you personally?
Yes, no, of course it is different. That's what I mean, that we can expect or we can demand to the digital connection to be the same like the real thing.
No.
But I think at this particular moment of the humanity, it's helping a lot. It's a kind of safe place where we can find the others, maybe not in a physical way, but they are there.
And as you say, it is a daily reality of our lives, and therefore it's really strange that it's not really part of fiction right now. That's an interesting point you make. Would you be so kind to read something to us from your book?
So here you go. And the Kentuckys. That was what most infuriated her. What was the whole stupid idea of the Kentuckys about? What were all those people doing, rolling around on other people's floor, watching how the other half of humanity brushed their teeth? Why didn't anyone collude with Kentuckys to hatch truly brutal plots? Why didn't anyone send a Kentucky loaded with explosive into a crowded central station and blow it all to smithereens? Why didn't any Kentucky user blackmail an air traffic controller and force him to immolate 5 planes in Frankfurt in exchange for his daughter's life? Why didn't even one single user out of the 1,000 who must be moving at that very moment over truly important papers, take note of some crucial detail and break the Wall Street markets or hack into some software network and make all the elevators fall simultaneously in a dozen skyscrapers? Why wasn't there a single miserable morning when thousands of consumers woke up dead from a simple bucket of lithium poured into a Brazilian milk factory? Why were the stories about Kentuckys so small, so intimate, stingy, unpredictable, so desperately human and quotidian?
Yeah, I love this. First of all these awful things that this Kentuckys could have done. And then you say, but she did, but they didn't, the character says. They were so awful human. And do you think this awful humanness, this kind of, this pettiness we have, Is this something that will save us in the end from technology, or, you know, will it maybe destroy us?
I don't know. It's a good question. I don't know. Maybe it's part of the big question of the book, you know, when scientists post questions, they have factual as answer. Mm-hmm. And for writers, when we post questions, we, as an answer, we get a long chain of more small and personal mm-hmm. questions. But it is a kind of answer. It's a very, I think at the end, it's a very pessimistic book.
Yeah, yeah. Why is this character so angry? Maybe, why is she so angry?
His character in particular?
Yeah, yeah. Why did you make this rant for her?
Because he has crossed a line between what was moral and political and ethical accepted yeah. and what is not. She crossed the line yeah. and she didn't realize where. Mm. And this is one of the big thing that the book is talking about, that they think that I think we have naturalized very quickly technology, but we ourselves don't know how to use it yeah. and how dangerous it is to cross that line.
Yeah, we still don't have our own moral set of codes how we deal with it. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I myself, meanwhile, I was writing the book, was for the first time crossing this line, tracing this line, yeah. you know, to yeah. understanding that, oh, this is really dangerous. I'm doing this all days. And this
yeah.
is, you know, yeah. But you have to stop and think about it.
Yeah. I really want to thank you for this interview. Wish you all the best and hope to see you one day in The Hague. Thank you very much, Samanta Schweblin.
Bye-bye.
Yes, bye-bye. And now we go to Jaap Tielbeke. He has been a member of the editorial staff of the Dutch weekly De Groene Amsterdammer since 2015. And in his book, A Better Environment Doesn't Start With Yourself, he argues that instead of waving the blame at each other, we should hold the real culprits accountable. Combating the climate crisis requires, in short, political action. Jaap.
Look at you, going door to door, pen at hand, little speech ready. You talk about the sea turtle threatened with extinction and say that people can help by donating a little money. You worry about the world at such a young age. In your aunt's garden, you look for woodlice. In the woods, you examine toadstools. And with your friends, you set up clubs to protect nature. I remember this sultry summer morning. You are helping in your nan's backyard, and the adults are talking about global warming. You ask what that is, the greenhouse effect. And your mother points to the glass house where your nan grows her tomatoes. When the sun shines, it gets very hot in there, she explains. And something similar is happening to the world. You nod. But it will take a while before you really understand what she means. You do what the world expects of you. Switch off the lights when you leave house, take your glass to the bottle bank, and don't shower too long. That is your way of helping the environment. And if everyone just follows your example, it'll all be all right. You are proud of the certificates for fundraising from the World Wildlife Fund that hang above your bed. And you dream of a career as a marine biologist. It is an unwritten promise that your life will be better than your parents, and they already have little to complain about. The end of history is in sight, and you can look forward to the future. So you grow up and embrace that ubiquitous belief in progress. Concerns about the disappearance of nature, or the sadness about the extinction of species, you dismiss as childish sentimentality. You know very well that forests are still being raised and that the greenhouse effect is only getting stronger, but you prefer not to think about it. The World Wildlife Fund, you don't renew your membership. And why must you set an example if nobody else follows? You believe that, in the end,
people will devise clever solutions for our self-created problems. Because isn't that what humankind has always done? I'm sometimes nostalgic for that optimism I now know was naive. I wonder what I will tell my children in the future. I often hear that we only have 10 years to avoid climate catastrophe. So when my hypothetical offspring is as old as you then, we'll know if we succeeded. Probably not. I wonder if I want children anyway, if I truly believe that the web of life is unraveling, leaving civilization hanging by a thread. But it's also too fatalistic to answer that question with a resounding no, because who am I to decide that the future isn't worth the effort anymore? Who says that there isn't any beauty or happiness to be found in a planet out of joint? And besides, future generations may well be our best hope of salvation. The children of today aren't doing what the world expects of them. They are rising up to change that world. They are refusing to go to school. And to the adults who are ruining their future, they raise their fists and they shout, "How dare you?" I'd like to advise you to follow their example, but my childhood is behind me. I am a member of the last generation who can turn the tide, even if I don't always know how. I read and despair. I write and try to combat that desperation. I still have my pen at hand and my little speech ready, but the message isn't getting any brighter. A journalist and environmental activist once told me, "I always try to find new and more persuasive ways of saying the same thing." Yes, I thought, and perhaps that is difficult enough in itself. Thank you.
Thank you, Jaap, for also sharing your doubts with us. And how mighty is the pen when dealing with a crisis like the climate crisis? And tomorrow we will hear from many more writers and spoken word artists on the issue of climate injustice. So I now will go to New York. Well, not actually, but we will have contact with Arnon Grunberg again. Hi, Arnon. Well, you have watched the program.
Yes.
Would you like me to ask you a question, or do you have already thoughts or remarks you want to share with us?
I have some thoughts and remarks, but no, start with a question. And then I can, if you didn't ask me the question, I was hoping I will say what I want to say anyhow.
Yeah, because when I listened to your talk, it seemed to me that the us, or what you call membership, it's almost appalling to you. Like it's something you try to avoid at all times, or maybe I misunderstood, but... And then I was thinking, has this idea of us not changed, but did you hear anything interesting about us that you maybe changed your thinking, or?
I heard many interesting things, but the point of a conversation or engaging with others is for me not so much to really change your own position, but to learn things. And maybe in the process of learning, this can be also a process of changing your own position. What I found very interesting, of course, is that as far as I'm concerned, in order to have an us, you always will have one kind of an enemy or another. You need an enemy, or you need an opponent.
Yeah.
And even if I was listening to Eva and I thought what she was saying was fairly interesting, is even if we include like all the other creatures, like goats, ants, or whatever, into this field of us, my question then is, what happens to somebody who says, "I don't want to be part of this group"? Is this creature going to be an enemy, an opponent? How are we going to treat this person? And also within the group of us, I think it's fairly naive to believe that there are no power structures, that there are no weaker creatures, weaker persons in this group who can be silenced by the more powerful. So I think in order I acknowledge also what Tsitsi said, of course, this is a huge history of tribalism, and I'm aware and I respect the fact that many people might have the desire more than I have to belong to a group, or they find comfort there, and that's all fine with me. I don't want to tell other people how they should live. My fear is, my concern is that too easily we tell other people how they should live. We define what's good and what's evil, and this already is a position of exercising power, even without acknowledging that you are exercising power. So I was warning to say that let's not too easily say for other people, on behalf of other people, this is the good life and here are the enemies. Mm-hmm. They are fighters. So for example, also, and then I will stop talking. I heard, I'm not sure who it was, but somebody said, okay, as an author, as a writer, basically you are obliged to be against the status quo. Mm-hmm. Of course, this you can. I'm not sure if you always should be against the status quo, but that's beyond the point now. Mm-hmm. But my first question, my first feeling was, what about authors who maybe support the status quo? Don't they belong to the group of authors? Should we exclude them? So I think we should think more, because that's the basis of a decent society, how we should treat our enemies. And I would say that it is maybe too big for us to love the neighbors. Jesus told us, and again, I'm not a Christian, but I think our Western culture is heavily influenced by Christianity. This is much too big, but I think we can strive to treat our enemies the way we want to be treated by these enemies.
Yeah. Very clear. Have you ever felt part of and us, and maybe it was the table tennis club where you could still have all the, you know, autonomy you wanted, you know? Was there ever an us that you encountered?
Yes, sometimes. I think being in love with somebody is already the desire to create a very small, tiny us.
Yeah.
Of course, there are moments that I feel extreme, that I feel there's an us. I mean, mm-hmm. there are moments in New York that I felt a New Yorker among other New Yorkers. Yeah. There was an us. Yeah.
And then
I want to defend the liberty, not only for myself, but for everybody, yeah. to get out of this us, yeah. and not to be defined by other people who you are, yeah. and what you should do.
Yeah, very clear. Thank you so much for this final thought. And good luck in New York. Yes, bye. So now we go to the grand finale of tonight. It is the Pen Freedom of Speech ceremony for the great Tsitsi Dangarembga. And before we go live again, or we are still live with Harare, but we will first watch a short video on the life and work of Tsitsi.
I do not understand myself to be an activist as such. I look at myself as a responsible citizen, someone who cares about the way the country is going. I am primarily a writer and filmmaker, and I look at social issues in my writing and in my screenplays. And so it was quite normal for me to be interested in the goings-on of society around me. I started demonstrating in response to what was happening around the COVID pandemic in Zimbabwe. So I had been out quite a number of times before the 31st of July. I've been writing professionally for 3 decades and more now. It has been such a struggle to write and to get people to understand where I am coming from as a writer and what I am talking about. Being shortlisted for the Booker Prize 2020 was an amazing moment in my career, and I just have a much higher profile as a writer. And the other thing is I feel more confident in myself. It is a relief when you arrive at 9 Walsh Road, where Widow Riley lives, without bumping into any acquaintances. You sit down on the drain bridge by the fence to squash your feet back into your pumps. Lips are all you see to begin with, and you are terrified. Swollen feet wedged into your lady dies, you leap up. The lips are arranged in a snarl around yellow teeth. They belong to a small, shaggy-haired terrier. Yow, yow, the dog yelps, outraged at your presence. Who are you? A high-pitched voice trembles through the morning air. Ndiwe ani, the woman repeats. She uses the singular, familiar form to address you. Since a person worth something is plural, where your value is concerned, this woman agrees with the dog. Now, I am writing a young adult dystopian speculative novel called Sai Sai and the Great Ancestor of Fire. It's about three young women at the end of school who are called to be world shifters by the ancestors. I'm writing this because I felt that there was a dearth of literature for young adults on the continent and in Zimbabwe that really speaks to the condition and the life that they experience. I want to write it in a way such that it emerges from African culture and it speaks to the way African cosmology configures the world. So engagement with the ancestors is something that people can understand. I chose speculative fiction because it is fantasy. It gives me a lot of space and breadth to deal with issues. And it's dystopian because the situation in most of our countries is very negative. We have difficult conditions that young people have to engage with. And these conditions come right from the top, the way power is used in our countries. And we experience it right down to the bottom, which is how we live our lives. Are we able to eat? Are we able to wash ourselves with water and keep clean? And so I wanted to engage with these things in a way that young people can understand.
It's too nice,
yeah. Making films for a person like me is very difficult in Zimbabwe because one has to be attached to channels of resources. Making films takes a lot of money, and you also need a lot of permissions, and so you have to be aligned to government in some way. And so if you are not aligned to government, it is very difficult to obtain funding and space to make films in Zimbabwe. However, things are changing. We see that there are calls for inclusivity and diversity in the film world, and I think this is going to impact Zimbabwe also. And as a result of it, I have begun talking to people outside the country, really from all over the world, on the continent, England and the USA. And I do believe that I will be able to make my films sooner rather than later. And I've been writing scripts in all this time that I have not been able to make films. I have been writing scripts and working with young people. And so I have a wealth of stories that are just waiting for me to bring to the screen. The 31st of July was meant to be an enormous nationwide demonstration in Zimbabwe against corruption and other issues of misgovernance. So a couple of days before the demonstration, the government declared it illegal. I found it really atrocious that my right to demonstrate, which is guaranteed by the Constitution, was being tampered with. And I felt that since I had been so vocal in support of the demonstration, and so I decided to go out anyway, in spite of the government call not to demonstrate. The way I see it is I was arrested because I had gone out to demonstrate when the government had banned a demonstration. We were not told when the police actually came to tell us to get into the riot vehicle. We were only told what you are doing is illegal. Well, the court case has been going on since the 1st of August because the day after the arrest, we were taken to court. We were fortunate to be given bail, and since then, we had to return for remand appearances about 9 times so far. The conditions in prison were appalling. There was no running water. There was no food. So unless you had someone to serve you 24 hours of the day, to run around and bring you drinking water and food to eat, you didn't get anything to eat at all. It was really shocking. One of the bathrooms had about an inch of water on the floor, but nothing in the cisterns. It was horrifying, and I only saw that in one day. I wouldn't like to see more. So the court case is still pending, and my next appearance would be on the 9th of February. I live in an environment where I was not able to practice my art and my craft. which meant that I had to use my creative energies for other things, for engaging with the situation as a citizen. That being the case, I'm glad that I am able to do the little things that I do. I think that what prompts me to undertake some kinds of actions is the same prompt that leads me to writing. This whole idea of imagination. Things do not have to be the way they are. They could be different. And I'm really hoping that I can get more support for my creative narrative production, because that really is who I am.
We will now listen to the president of PEN International, Jennifer Clements, speaking to us from Mexico City.
Good evening to everyone from Mexico, where I'm spending these days during the global pandemic. Above all, this evening, I would like to give my condolences to any of you who may have lost a loved one or a friend to this illness. I'd also like to underscore how truly sad I am not to be in The Hague, a city that has often been the stage for humanity's most noble hours. I send a warm greeting to my friends at the festival and its director, Ellen Wall-Raven, as well as our colleagues at PEN Netherlands. This year, PEN celebrates its centenary, and it's a true honor to begin this special year giving a prize that acknowledges some of the bravest writers in the world. One of the founding values of PEN is that literature can and does play a significant role in developing mutual understanding and world culture. PEN also stands for freedom of expression and acts as a powerful voice on behalf of writers who are harassed, imprisoned, and even killed for their work. Since PEN was established 100 years ago, our members across the globe have been the voice of the silenced. At the time when PEN International turns 100 this year, our PEN Emergency Fund also reaches a milestone. The PEN Emergency Fund was established 50 years ago by the Dutch author A. den Doorlaard and has played a crucial role in our work, as it allows us to aid seriously persecuted writers, writers in exile, or those who need to rebuild their lives after detention or mistreatment. Back in 1971, Henrik Bol, as president of PEN International, gave the fund half of his award money from the Nobel Prize in Literature in order to ensure that this crucial help could continue. I'd like to name here the board members who are the exceptional custodians of the PEN Emergency Fund. René Appel, member, Pauline Lutz, member, Wim Jor, treasurer, and Job Dehenar, president. Today it is a true honor to give the PEN Freedom of Expression Award to Tsitsi Dangarembga and recognize her constant commitment to literature as well as her advocacy, which addresses some of the burning issues in Zimbabwe. In addition, Dangarembga's work addresses the role of women and the rampant misogyny in her country. And one of my favorite quotes from her novel, Nervous Conditions, is a question asked. She writes, "Can you cook books and feed them to your husband?" Tsitsi Dangarembga, we celebrate you and thank you for your words, your films, and your courage. Thank you.
And for now, we're going for a short speech by Eliza July. He's president of PEN Zimbabwe. And since there is a strict lockdown in Harare, he can't be with Tsitsi, but he symbolically, by speech, will hand over to her the award.
It is my privilege to be part of this great event where our own Tsitsi Dangarembga has been awarded with the PEN Award for Freedom of Expression. In acknowledgement of your remarkable contribution in the fight for freedom of expression, I would like to say on behalf of PEN Zimbabwe family, congratulations. It is not by chance that you have been awarded with this prestigious award, but it is a deserved privilege. We are operating in an environment where there is freedom of expression, but without freedom after expression. It is not an easy thing for you to go out there to be a voice for the voiceless. We are really grateful. I would also want to appreciate PEN International and all its working partners for giving us this honor. It goes to show that their eyes are everywhere to acknowledge and notice every deserved effort towards this fight for freedom of expression. I am grateful, and I would like to say once more, thank you.
Yeah, Tsitsi Dangarembga, congratulations with the PEN Freedom of Expression Awards. I think I lost, yeah. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Ah,
yes.
Good. Well, congratulations. Being a voice of the voiceless, is that what connects all the things you do in your work, the books, the films, the activism?
In fact, I do not see myself as being a voice of the voiceless. I see myself as a citizen participating in creating my society. And in order to do that, I need to engage with a diverse range of situations in my society. And from that point of view, yes, definitely, it is the same impulse that causes me to write, that causes me to go out onto the street or to make certain statements when I feel this is necessary.
Yeah, and you really talked also in your film about this, the power of imagination being kind of the thing that connects it all.
Yes, absolutely. When, for me, if I see something that I think is not ideal, and of course things never are, I do not want to be stopped by the fact that things are not ideal. I like to ask myself, well, how can they be made more ideal? Yeah. And I think this is what happens when I write. I ask myself, how can I make this more engaging to say what I want to say? If I look into society, I can ask myself, how can I contribute to making people aware that we need to have ambulances, that it is not correct to leave people without food or with such foods that we have a crisis of malnutrition in children under five. And for me, that is, those kinds of behaviors and activities are all issues of imagination.
Yes. Well, we've also heard that you still have a court case coming up in February. And then the question rises here, like, is there anything we can do? Like, does international praise like this, does it help, or is it maybe sometimes also a complicating factor, this attention?
Well, thank you very much for asking whether there's anything that can be done to help. Definitely, I think raising awareness that unjust cases are being brought to court in this way is really important. It is, in some ways, a double-edged sword because, of course, when we talk about the us and the we are the people who are correct, and the other can often then be cast as the enemy. And so the narrative in Zimbabwe is that Western society is the enemy. Yeah. So engagement with Western society can easily be said to mean that one is working with Western society against Zimbabwe. So that is a negative side of it. Yeah. However, my feeling is that if we allow that kind of lying attitude to stop us doing what is right, then we have put ourselves on the path of defeat. And so I think it is very important for people who can speak out in solidarity and act in solidarity with people who are harassed or persecuted to continue to do so, even if there might be some negative consequences. I think perhaps if that negative consequence goes as far as death, then perhaps one can consider what the best strategy, but that's not the situation that I am facing.
Okay. Well, then for now, I would like to say, stay safe, stay strong, and we really hope to see you one day in The Hague. And for our audience, please read this beautiful book, The Mournable Body. Thank you so much, and congratulations again.
Thank you very much.
So I really would like to thank all the contributors of tonight. And you can read all their stories about It's Up to Us online. I want to thank Eva, Raoul, Arnon, Selina, Simone and Jaap. And I hope this evening has inspired you as well as confused you or at least puzzled you. And that the next time you refer to us, of we, you think, who am I actually referring to? And if you want to hear more, please join us for the next couple of days, every evening at 8:30, live here from Theater aan het Spui. And we will finish with a contribution of the Theater of Wrong Decisions. And this organization honors every year worldwide killed journalists and writers. It's a short video of 1 minute. I'll thank you all for tonight. Have a good evening. We'll now watch the video. Goodbye.
Truth will come to light. Murder cannot be hid long.